Hey there, everybody. Steve the Amateur Historian, and I have got something interesting for you. You know, off and on I do this series where I show off, like, somewhat rare vinyls that I've purchased. Well, I got another vinyl recently, and this is not a just a, oh, here's my obscure vinyl, check that out. It's not another one of those videos, because this vinyl actually has a story behind it, and when I purchased this, I was just trying to complete a collection, and I didn't even think about how purchasing this certain item might go wrong, so to speak. It's a positive and a negative in terms of I didn't get what I wanted exactly, but I got something that is very distinct to musical history, so I'm not going to complain. Anyway, this is the story of my favorite musician of all time, Billy Joel's first album, released in 1971, Cold Spring Harbor.
Steve the Amateur Historian.
So as I've started more and more over the years, becoming more and more of a mainstream Portlander, even though I was born and raised here, you know, first it's developing a love of kombucha, and then it's developing yourself a nice vinyl collection. As I started collecting vinyls, like, I knew I was going to want to get all of Billy Joel's stuff, because you just do that for your favorite guy. And my first haul, seriously, like, $18 on eBay, they were in flawless condition. I got 6 albums of his. I got, all in successive order. I got Turnstiles from 76, I got The Stranger, which you have to have, from 77, 52nd Street from 78, Glass Houses from 1980, The Nylon Curtain, which I believe was, I always forget if it's 81 or 82, isn't it 82, okay, I always want to say 81, and then I have 2 copies of this now, because my girlfriend got me a copy of The Innocent Man, which actually, I think this is the one she got me, but that was part of the haul, and I'm like, well, I'm not going to say no just because there's an extra copy of an LP when I can get 6 vinyls for like $18. So that was like half of his discography. And then over time, I've collected a few more. I still have to get like 3 more albums of his. Stormfront costs like a bajillion infinity dollars, so I don't know when I'm going to get that. But like recently, I got his very underrated 73 album, Street Life Serenade. And just the other day, I got The Bridge from 1986, which people are critical of, but I think it's, I still think it's good. I definitely don't think it's his best album, but I think people are a little too critical. So I've come very close to completing that collection. And along with Street Life Serenade, I got Cold Spring Harbor, which was his first album released in 1971. Billy Joel's, you know, history as a musician performing in bands went back into like his early teens. So like he'd been doing this for a while. He was in a few different bands. He was in the Hassles, he was in Attila, and finally by, you know, as the 70s were kicking off, he was kind of moving into a place where it seems like he was going to start doing his own thing. And he fell in love with the concept of singer-songwriters. He loved people like, you know, Jackson Brown and people like that. And I feel like Cold Spring Harbor, as I understand it, I think Billy Joel doesn't really love the album that much. And I mean, considering what he did afterwards, I can understand that to a degree. But I definitely feel if you've got a musician who wants to be a singer-songwriter and they have their specialty instrument, in his case, a piano, Cold Spring Harbor is a very solid early 70s representation of, you know, the singer with their primary instrument just making some music, expressing their thoughts and ideas and feelings. And this album is very, I mean, obviously all his albums are, you know, piano or keyboard heavy, but this one is particularly piano heavy. I think like half the songs on the album don't even really have any percussion or really not really a lot of other background instruments. And you know, this was the album that was going to get him off the ground. And Cold Spring Harbor is in relation to a location in New York. That's where he came from. His you know, he's always had at least an essence of New York to him. And so his first album was in reference to this place called Cold Spring Harbor. Now, when you're having, this is like your first solo album, like you're hoping, you know, you don't necessarily think you're going to blow up, but you're hoping for something solid that's going to maybe at least get you a little something going, get you a little bit of a name. It's got to be strong, because a lot of performers don't get a second chance. A lot of bands get that one chance to make an album, and if it flops, they're done. They're gone. So you need it to be as perfect as you can get it. So Billy Joel signed a 10-album contract with a company called Family Productions. So a smaller production company. And after recording all of his songs, when they mastered it at a speed that was just slightly too high. I read that it was 7% faster than it was supposed to be. And of course, what happens when you speed up sound? Everything gets higher pitched. So he kind of started sounding a little bit, you know, not quite to that point, but he started sounding kind of like, you know, a chipmunk. And he even said, like, that's what he compared it to. He's like, I sound like Alvin and the Chipmunks on this thing. Especially if in the original speed of the recording, he was singing at a higher pitch. It was, you know, it was shooting through the ceiling. So it was mastered and released like that. So pretty much his first released album was screwed up. And there's, I guess, a story, I don't know if it's true, that like after the first time he heard it, he took the record, ran out in the street, and just chucked it in the street. He had to be so pissed, because it's like, this is my start as a solo musician. And I'm just squeaking like a chipmunk. Now, this led to him, because he was stuck in this contract. I've listened to, he has some really good masterclass recordings that you can find on YouTube and possibly other places, where he talks about this time period and how it was obvious that this relationship with Family Productions was not was not long for this world. And he's, you know, he was stuck, and he talks about kind of how the origins of the song Piano Man came from was, you know, he lived in New York, or in the New York area. He, you know, grew up there. He split and took off to L.A. And he would work in bars as, you know, the piano guy. And that's kind of where he got the essence of the song Piano Man. And by the mid-70s, and you can really feel it on his album Turnstiles, when he talks about going back to New York. And the first song on the album is Say Goodbye to Hollywood. And then later on, there's New York State of Mind. So you can see he was ready to go back to the East Coast where he came from. And he ultimately managed to get out of this record deal and sign with Columbia. And I think the main production guy running Family Productions, like, he would still get royalties off of his music that he did with Columbia. That was their way to kind of schmooze him over, like, let him out of this so we can have him, but you'll still get a little money out of it. And that was kind of the tumultuous experience of his first album. Now, by 1983... the album was finally remixed and remastered and brought to the right speed, so it actually kind of sounded like Billy Joel's regular singing voice. And in his earlier albums, he does have, in some ways, and again, it's probably that singer-songwriter element of him. Some songs, he sings them a little more high and a little bit more folksy than he did later when he really started getting an edge. The only song that you really get, you hear that edge in his voice that he had with later albums like The Stranger and 52nd Street and Glass Houses, is there's a brief portion of the song Tomorrow Is Today where he talks about going down to the river, and you hear a little bit of that rasp that he was known for. It's, you know, numerous other things when he's saying. And that song is actually based, the words in it are based around his contemplation of committing suicide when he was young. And I think the effects of that are still, at least to some degree, weigh on him, because it's a song he won't ever play. I remember one of the master classes I listened to, because he'll periodically be like, I've been talking for like 20 minutes, let me play something for you, and people will scream suggestions. And I remember in one particular one, you hear people, you know, they're yelling, you know, whatever, and he's like, okay, and then you hear someone yell, Tomorrow Is Today. And you literally hear Billy Joel go, no, I'm not playing that. And you can understand why. And, you know, I bought this album on CD many years ago, and that was the remixed, fixed version of this album where things sounded right. And I wasn't even thinking about it when I went on eBay, because I was like, I need to finish my Billy Joel vinyl collection. And I found this copy of Cold Spring Harbor for pretty cheap. It was like $4, $3 shipping. So it's like $7. That's not bad. And it wasn't until like 15 minutes after I made the purchase that I paused and I was like, well, wait a minute. What version of Cold Spring Harbor am I going to get? Am I going to get the messed up original version? Or I'm going to get the more, I guess, acknowledged version that's actually fixed up? And everything's brought to the right levels. Well, I'm, to a degree, happy to say that this version that got sent to me, and you can see, like, in the corners, you can see the wear and tear. Like, this is an LP in particular that has seen some shit, so to speak. So that started making me think this might be an original. And while I want a copy of Cold Spring Harbor on vinyl that sounds the way it's supposed to sound, I was like, I would be elated if I actually, because I don't know how many copies of these were made, so I don't really necessarily think they're like extremely rare or extremely valuable or anything. It's just the oddity of the whole thing that I really was like, you know what? I'm going to be kind of excited if when my copy of Cold Spring Harbor I bought shows up, it's going to be an original from the 70s. So I got this, and again, I saw the weathering and so on, and I'm like, does this fit? And there's ways you can tell. It's a little hard. You know, I put it on the turntable and I listen and like, I'll hear one part of a song and be like, that sounds a little sped up from what I remember. But then there'll be like one song where he starts singing and I'm like, well, this sounds pretty much like how I remember the song being. Of course, you know, it was only sped up 7%. So at just a general listen, I was kind of vacillating back and forth. It wasn't until the fifth track on the album, which is called Falling of the Rain, which I love. There's beautiful, like, you know, crazy kind of keyboard bit at the start. And I could tell immediately when I started playing that track that the piano playing, because it's already really fast, that it was extremely fast. And so I was like, yeah, I'm pretty sure this is one of the original, you know, not, you know, reissued later, but this is the original 1971 Family Productions versions of Billy Joel's first album. And one thing I'm actually surprised about is that it's in, you know, independently of the sleeve it's in, the LP's not in terrible condition, you know, for being almost 50 years old. And here's another way you can tell is because, you know, Columbia kind of started taking over. Most of Billy Joel's albums were through Columbia, and, you know, they would still acknowledge that, you know, Family Productions did, but, like, on the CD I have of Cold Spring Harbor, it still shows the Columbia record label on there, and there's no reference to Columbia anywhere on this vinyl, but you have the Family Productions logo and name on there. So that's another indicator that this is probably an original from 71 that wasn't mastered properly. And you can see in the light, there's a few markings, but honestly, for the age of this thing, and who knows how much it was played, it's not in bad condition. And I'm wondering if, you know, anybody who bought these albums and then, like, listens to Billy Joel's later stuff and goes back and listens to this, and they're like, why does his voice sound so high? Why was he just going a different way in his music? They may not realize that it wasn't mastered properly. You've got, like, the original sleeve that it came in. But another important way of acknowledging is you can find the time lengths of the songs now, and obviously on this, the times of each track are on the back, because if every song was sped up slightly for this version of the album, all the songs are inevitably going to be a little bit shorter. If there's a song that at normal speed is 3 minutes long, the version on here might be 2 minutes and 50 seconds because it's sped up. And so I started looking at these and I started noticing the times on these songs are a little bit low for what I remember. For instance, She's Got Away, which is probably the only real, Everybody Loves You Now was kind of somewhat well-known, at least by Billy Joel fans, but She's Got Away is a song that's actually like a fairly iconic song. And I think it was rejuvenated when he did it as part of his Songs in the Attic live album, I think that was in 1981. And that's kind of the version that's more well-known. It's the version of the song that's on his Greatest Hits album. But I knew that version the original version from, or at least the original studio version from this album on CD was about 3 minutes long. So I look at this sleeve and you can see at the top here, first song, She's Got Away, it's only 2 minutes and 40 seconds long. So you can, I could tell right away, all these songs are a little bit shorter. And here's another thing, you could, another way to distinguish between them, because on the CD version I have, the second song on the album is called You Can Make Me Free. And like most tracks on the album, it's about 3 minutes long or so. You know, 2.5 to 3 minutes. And that's where most of the songs are on this album. And that's because when they redid it in 83, they hacked out a really long music solo, straight music solo, out of the end of the song. So the original version of You Can Make Me Free is considerably longer than the redone version. And you'll notice on here, You Can Make Me Free, the second track, says it's 5 minutes and 40 seconds long. It's almost a 6 minute long song mixed in with all these 2.5 to 3.5 minute long songs. So, you know, it became pretty obvious that this was an original 1971 copy of the album. And I'm pleased as punch. I'm happy that I actually have this, even though I still want to get a vinyl of the, you know, fixed up one. And this isn't such a terrible listen. You know, again, it's only a little bit faster. You know, if you've heard the songs enough times, you can see, you can feel the little, you know, nuances, the slight differences in the tracks. But I've always had a very, I mean, of course, I love most of Billy Joel's albums, but I've always had a real soft spot for this one. I didn't really know what to expect because, you know, it's like, it's his first album. I know he didn't really love it that much. So I thought, is this going to be just kind of a dud, just kind of a, you know, throw some songs together and get an album out there? And there's a lot of feelings and emotion in the songs in this album. And again, you know, Tomorrow Is Today was a song about him contemplating suicide. She's Got Away is, in my opinion, one of the best love songs of the 70s, you know, even with how simplistic it is. Everybody Loves You Now kind of has some appeal. I think Falling of the Rain, which is very, it's a very fantasy-ridden song, but the music, the piano music is phenomenal in it. And, you know, Turn Around, You Look So Good to Me. These are simple songs, but they're songs that are, you know, and a lot of them have emotion. And then like a song like You Look So Good to Me is kind of upbeat and fun. And it's like you're walking down the dirt road into town with your gal on your arm. Not that it's like a country song. And then it ends with a song that I absolutely love. It's probably one of my top, not way up at the top, but it's probably near the bottom of my top 25 favorite Billy Joel songs, which is Got to Begin Again, which is the song that ends the album, and a song that I think is, again, like a lot of the songs here, fairly simple, but there's great emotion to it. And as I've said in the past, talking about music, a good way for your music to get my attention and to get me liking it is if you can trigger an emotion in me with your music. And that's why I don't like a lot of contemporary music, because a lot of it is so lacking in emotion. So, you know, when I realized what I truly had here, I knew I was going to have to do a video talking about this kooky story about this guy that's a household name. You know, he was one of the biggest stars in music of the 70s and 80s, and a lot of, you know, bands today, you know, look back and revere this guy. And, you know, to think that his solo career got off on such a bizarre foot, and that you can still find, you know, direct reminders of that today is really awesome. So I'm really happy that by total fluke accident, I wasn't even thinking about it, I was able to get this album.
She's got a way about her. I don't know what it is. She's got a way about her. I don't know what it is.
So yeah, the distinctions between the two are small overall. Sometimes you can barely notice the difference, but when you really do see the difference, it sticks out like a sore thumb, and I could understand my man Billy Joel being pissed that this is his first album and this is how it's all going down. I'd have probably chucked it out in the street as an initial response too. But from my side, you know, he went on to have an astronomically amazing career, so in the end everything turned out okay, I think. So I'm glad to have this little piece of bizarre musical history, even if it could be regarded as a total screw up. So that's it. That's the story behind Billy Joel's tumultuous first album, which I managed to randomly get a copy. And I'm still kind of in awe about it. Like, I was not expecting this to happen. She ruined that. Anyway, as always, guys, remember to like, share, subscribe, hit up my Patreon if you want to help me out that way. And till next time, this has been Steve, the Amateur Historian. Shut up!